9:30. It's a real pleasure to see you all tonight, and I want to take a quick second to improv a real thanks to our hosts here for the FA Social Club. This place is beautiful. They're really graciously hosting us for this event tonight. And a shout out to Amy and she, our club president, vice president, and boss of Rotaract, who have worked really hard to bring this all together. We're here tonight to celebrate and discuss the history of women leaders in our organization after a really fortunate chance meeting with our speaker, Carol, who I'll introduce to you all in a moment. So Rotary International, for those of you who might not be familiar, was founded in 1905. It's a global community of more than 1.2 million like-minded individuals and 35,000 clubs who have a passion for community service. The organization has a long history of improving communities at home and around the world. And those of us who are young professionals here are largely members of Rotaract, which is a Rotary Club partner of young professionals who share the value of service above self. So I think that as we look around the room today, and as I look around the room at my Rotaract Club, it's hard to believe, actually, that the Rotary International Constitution limited membership in Rotary to men only until as recently as 1989. Which was 2 years after a landmark U.S. Supreme Court case that mandated gender equality in Rotary in the United States. Women today, obviously, are leaders in their businesses and their communities, and in my highly biased opinion, these landmark changes that opened up Rotary to women were much for the better. Rotary and the world it serves have really transformed since 1905. And today there are more than 200,000 women in Rotary, comprising about 20% of Rotary's membership. It's a vast improvement, and I believe that we have more work to do. Our clubs really must reflect and represent our communities, and that means taking steps toward inclusiveness and diversity, of which gender diversity is a very important part. This evening, we're really fortunate. We're going to hear from women who shine as leaders through Rotary, and we'll learn about their experiences through a period of change in an organization that we all believe in. I hope that we'll take this model of change and learn from it. I'd really like to see us use it to take a closer look about how we can work every day to make our clubs better reflect our communities as we strive to be inclusive of every person. So that said, it's my distinct honor to introduce Carol Agate, without whom I would not be up here speaking to you all as a Rotarian. Carol, who retired in 2009, relocated to Cambridge, spent 21 years as an administrative law judge in California. She says her most exciting project as a lawyer was representing a local Rotary Club in a lawsuit against Rotary International. From beginning to end, the lawsuit took 9 years and culminated in women's inclusion in Rotary. Carol started out assuming her career would be taking care of children and husband until reading The Feminine Mystique changed her plans. Betty Friedan's inspiring work pushed her further. Having been active in politics, she thought law school would be an interesting next step. She worked as a prosecutor in the city of Los Angeles, a bar exam reader, a legal clinic lawyer, a clinical professor of law, and the research attorney to the Chief Justice of American Samoa. So please join me in welcoming Carol. And a quick note that if any of you are on social media this evening and want to share the story of women in Rotary, do the hashtag women in Rotary, you can tweet or Instagram at Boston Rotaract. And I will turn it over to you.
Thank you. Is this working okay? Yeah. Thanks very much for inviting me tonight. It's always exciting to see what's happened to Rotary. I never knew anything about Rotary, but I was affiliated with the ACLU. I was on the Lawyers Advisory Committee. Is this better?
Yes.
Okay. So there was a specialist in women's issues who was an employee of the ACLU, and she got appointed to the bench. So she was handing off all her cases, and there were two options she gave me. I can't remember what the other option was, but that settled in about a week, so I'm glad I took the other option. And that was the Duarte Rotary Club. Duarte is a small town, a suburb of Los Angeles, and it has only one industry in town, and that's the City of Hope. I don't know how well Easterners know about the City of Hope, but it's a major cancer center, one of the biggest on the West Coast. And it's just about the only industry there isn't Gordy. Gordy is the City of Hope, plus a few homes. So that didn't give the Rotary Club too much to go on. And they were getting very small. And the district governor was worried he didn't want to lose one of the clubs under his watch. And a couple of women applied to Rotary. And the president of the local chapter thought, you know, I'm not sure if women are allowed or not. We don't have any, but I'll ask the district governor. So he asked the district governor and was told, well, why don't you put Donna's name down as D and put Barbara's name down as B and send in their names that way. So he did, and time went by, and Dwarty was enjoying its two women members, and the third one joined. And then somebody came from the national board and was a little shocked to find that those women sitting there in the audience were actually Rotarians. And he said, this is not allowed. So he took the news back to headquarters, and headquarters told Dwarty that they would have to kick out the women. Now, these men of Dwarty were not exactly pioneers. They were not people who were interested in challenging the law, but they weren't going to kick out their members. So they became the ex-Rotary Club of Dwarty, and they took the Rotary banner and they put a great big fat X in front of it, and that was their logo for the next 9 years. So I took the place of the ACLU employee to act as advisor to the lawyer who was working on the case. And he was a Rotarian in the town of Acadia, which was near Dwarty. The school board of Dwarty was one of his clients. So the lawsuit was brought under the California Public Accommodations Act. And the Public Accommodations Act entitles all persons, regardless of gender, to equal accommodations in all business establishments in California. So the issue was, is Rotary a business establishment? That was the issue under the California law. And my co-counsel was the lawyer in charge of the trial court. And I argued the feminist perspective in the case, but he handled all of the examination of the witnesses. And we had witnesses that showed all the business advantages of Dwarty. The fact that 96% of the members, their employers paid, most of the members, their employers paid the dues. 96% of the members of Rotary deducted their dues from their income tax. They argue that Rotary does not provide its members with goods or services, which is part of the business part of the Public Accommodations Act. And they said, we're strictly a charitable organization. We have nothing to do with business. Well, of course, the limitation of one person per business made it a little hard for them to hold up that argument. But we knew when we got there that that judge was very skeptical about letting women into places that had been for men, and there was no persuading him. So we lost to the trial court. So the next appeal was to the California Court of Appeal, and at that point I took over as the attorney of record. And the Court of Appeal upheld, the Court of Appeal reversed the trial court and ruled in our favor. They found that it had business-like attributes. It had a complex structure. It was not just people gathering in someone's home. It had a large staff and budget. It had extensive publishing activities, and business concerns were a motivating factor in joining it. And the members capitalized on those business connections. And as far as goods and services, They said magazines and other publications are given to the members. They're entitled to wear the Rotary emblem. And they may attend conferences teaching managerial and professional techniques. So based on that, the Court of Appeal decided in our favor. Now, up to this point, we had wonderful relations with a lawyer on Rotary. He was a local lawyer. He even invited me to the Jonathan Club. The Jonathan Club is the fanciest business club in Los Angeles. I had never been there. And I wouldn't have gone ordinarily because I wouldn't go to a club that discriminated. But I was curious to see what it was like. So we had that kind of relationship that he invited me to lunch. And it was clear that he really didn't want to win, but that does not mean he did not do the best job he could possibly have done. It turned out that Rotary International's office in Chicago, they really didn't want to win because it turned out that the American Rotarians, every 3 years at the international conference, they had brought the resolution of women be entitled to join Rotary. And they were always defeated by the international Rotarians. So then we thought after they lost in the California Court of Appeal, they appealed to the California Supreme Court, by the way, and the California Supreme Court was satisfied with the decision of the Court of Appeal. So they turned down they did not grant them the right to appeal. So we never thought they would take it to the United States Supreme Court because having lost in California meant only that they had to admit Rotarians in California. Why would they want a national decision? But of course, I forgot that they probably would have preferred the national decision rather than have one state that had Rotarians. So they did petition to the United States Supreme Court, and we didn't think the Supreme Court would take it because the JCs were pending. I don't know, are people familiar with the JCs?
Yeah.
And that case was pending, but much to our surprise, the Supreme Court did take it. And I realized that the JCs are actually an easier case because they are clearly business related, whereas with Rotary, that was always an argument. But the Supreme Court, at this point, by the way, it had been about 6 years. Because they had also tried to transfer us to federal court and they lost that, but that took a couple of years to do that. And then getting into the California courts takes a while. So then we waited 2 more years after the Supreme Court decided that they would take it because since the JC's case was pending, they wanted the decision in that first. So after the JC's case was decided, in favor of the women who were challenging the exclusion from the JCs. We went to the United States Supreme Court, which was really an exciting thing. The preparation beforehand was interesting because the legal director of the Southern California ACLU had argued all of the Southern California cases that went into the Supreme Court. So he had a lot of experience arguing the Supreme Court. Even though I was the attorney of record, there was no way I was going to argue it because I had never argued in an appellate court. My experience had all been in the trial court. So somehow or other to start your first case in the Supreme Court didn't sound like the best idea. So we had a lot of what they call mooting, where you do a moot court, in effect, you pretend, you know, you have the parties pretend, and the legal director was terrible. He had never argued a case involving feminism. He knew nothing about it. He just, the director did not know what to do. So the director decided that we had to tell him he couldn't do it. He said, this is the hardest thing I've ever done. So then we had to find somebody to argue it. and we got a professor at the University of Southern California. And it wound up great because after the decision, USC had a clipping service and we kept getting all these clippings and at the press all over the country, so that was fun. So anyway, the oral argument was split between the ACLU and the state of California. And that's because one issue was whether the California law is constitutional, so it was the Attorney General of California who had to argue that case. We were arguing the Rotary Association case because that was the basis on which Rotary was bringing it. So the highest court of California had already decided that the Public Accommodations Act applied to Rotary, so that could not be the issue. Rotary was arguing that the constitutional right to free association was being violated by Rotarians being told who they had to associate with. It's a pretty tough argument to make when you have, what, a million members or so just in the United States. I'm not sure how many it was, but certainly they didn't all know each other. It wasn't quite like the local poker game. So, in order to encourage growth, they held, and we argued, that clubs must welcome visitors from other clubs. Well, visitors from other clubs are not people they know, so where's the right of free association there? So we won the decision, and that very day, Lions and Kiwanis announced that they were admitting women. And I got a phone call from McNeil Lehrer Report. I don't know how many people remember it, but that was the most prestigious news program. And they called me and asked if I would appear on the program. My gosh, this was a Friday morning, and the program was that evening. I said, sure. I was very excited about it. They called a little later in the day, and more important news bumped me. That was Gary Hart. Most of you were probably saying, oh, you're not too young, okay. Gary Hart was caught by the reporters who tracked him down to a motel with a woman. And that was more important than Rotary admitting women. So I never made it onto the pillow. So I spoke at a lot of Rotary clubs after that. And then 20 years later, somebody tracked me down from the Rotary Club of Duarte. And they had Googled and found me and asked me if I would come talk to them at their 20th anniversary. They had assembled a panel of everybody who had any role at all in the case and various representatives from the Rotarian clubs. And it was just fantastic. It was a huge turnout. And the thing that amazed me is that so many of the women there didn't know that Rotary hadn't always admitted women. So, I look forward to hearing what's happening now.
Thank you, Carol. I know that many of us have thanked you today, but I want to personally thank you for changing my life and making Rotary accessible to me.
Would have happened by now.
Maybe, but it probably happened sooner because of your involvement, or at least in part. I'm Amy Collinsworth. I know some of you in the room and others I don't, but I'll just introduce myself. I am the president of Boston Rotaract Club for 2016-2017. And I'm so glad you're all here to hear from Carol and these fabulous panelists who I'll introduce to you in a moment. Because of this landmark decision and about 20 years after that, I found Rotary because I was into community service and I was fortunate to have a local Rotary club who did believe in bringing women to the table. And they had a scholarship program that specifically was for women.
So I received a scholarship to go to college, and then I saw a Rotaract table at the club and org fair, and I thought, I've got to join this organization, or at least learn more about this organization that found me worthy of investing in. And it allowed me to pay back that scholarship to so many other people through the good work I get to do through Rotaract and meet amazing people. So thank you, Elise, for being a part of that. But I just thought I'd share that story because of the theme of tonight and women in Rotary, and there have been clubs doing this for many years. And I think that Carol's right, the United States has believed in bringing this equity to fruition. So we hope that this discussion will keep that balance going and bringing more women to the table. So tonight we've got three amazing women. We've got Elise Cadigan here to the right of Carol. She is currently serving as one of six Rotarians on the Rotary Foundation Programs Committee. She is the past district governor and currently a Rotarian in District 6420 in Illinois, and flew all the way out here from Chicago this morning to be here with you tonight. Welcome, Elise. I should mention that I will be mentioning a few of the things that these women have done through Rotary, but the list is so much longer, and they're just awesome, and you can read more about it in your programs. Next to Elise, to the right of her, we've got Julia Phelps. She has served as a president's representative and the Rotary Foundation alumni chair for Zone 32, and most recently served as Rotary International Director from 2014 to 2016, and is a Rotarian in our district as well. Welcome, Julia. And on the other end of the table, we've got Sheryl Meehan. She's our 2016-2017 district governor for 7930. She's a past president of the Haverhill Rotary Club in 2011-2012 and also served many years on the board of directors. Her home club is now the Danvers Rotary Club. At the district level, she has served as an assistant governor for two different years. Welcome. So we've got a few questions that are on the table. Feel free to answer as you wish, and even to kind of feed off of each other in dialogue. And I think Chi will be keeping us moving along since we started a little bit late. After this, we'll move into a Q&A with Carol and our three panelists. So for our Rotarians on the panel, when did you join Rotary in relation to this landmark case? And what was your perception of Rotary culture, how accepting of women they'd be before you joined? Was your experience after joining what that perception was? Did it meet the perception, or was it different? We'll start with Elise here.
Greetings, everybody. I am sitting here speechless in awe of Carol, and for those who know me, which actually means maybe, she knows how hard it is for me to be speechless. So I am acquainted with Sylvia Woodrock, and she's such a powerhouse, the woman who was the plaintiff in that landmark decision. She represented me.
That's true.
That's right. Good point. I joined in 88. That would be 1988. I didn't know that I was illegal in Rotary at the time. I joined because this wonderful medical director and hospital administrator asked me if I would come talk to his Rotary Club and talk about adolescent issues with addiction, and that happened to be something that I have an outpatient mental health practice, and I'm sure I can talk about that. And it was kind of new information then. So he said, don't worry, they'll listen to you, but there will be probably a table that will fall asleep, and there's probably gonna be some of the people in the club that will leave while you're talking, so don't take it personally. And I'm pretty thick-skinned, so I was really glad that he said that, because that would have been strange. They didn't, as far as I could tell, fall asleep, and they didn't leave. And I didn't know what to make of that, but I was really happy. I felt somewhat approved of. even though I was talking about kind of a controversial subject at the time. And I let it go. I found them to be a friendly bunch of men, and I went back to my practice happily. And a few months later, Bob Henry, the physician, came to my office and asked me if I would join that club. Now, I think under a lot of circumstances, I would have said, gosh, thank you so much. However, I just have too many things on my plate. And I did a lot of service in the Rockford area, community service, and I could have said that. But I respected him so much, and I really felt like he knew something about me. Not that I told him, I just felt like he did. It was something about me that suggested to him that it might be a good match, and I thought, okay, I'll do my best. And so I joined September 15th of 88. They had 3 women, past tense, kind of, at the point that I joined. So I wasn't the first of that club, but I was the first one that came to meetings. One had just left after a few months. The other one was president of the college, and she was never there. She was out fundraising. And the other one was very aging and just couldn't make the meetings. So I was the only woman among about 250 men in that club. And I had a ball. I would have to tell you, they were so kind and so kind of really extraordinarily friendly to me, except that one table. It didn't take me long to figure out the table that was going to fall asleep and probably leave. And they were the old guys, and Bob did tell me somewhere along the line that that table, well, he didn't really say that table, but he knew I knew, that there was a group of men who stood and screamed and threatened to leave and threatened to shut the club down if women were allowed in. So, it was my personal challenge in my own need to be accepted or need to see if I could kind of help them see the value of women in Rotary. I don't know what was going on with me, but when one of them was sick, and they're really old, so one of them definitely got sick, and I went to the table and asked if I could join them. And I did that every month or two or three that somebody was sick. And they were very begrudging at first, but not blatantly rude, and it kind of moved from there to saying, oh, of course, and I felt like they were somewhat supportive of me as a person, and I really was never sure that had to do with women, it just had to do with me at that moment. When I first realized that they supported women in Rotary was not until 1999, when I became the first woman president of that club, and it was a secret, and we hold on to it as a tradition, and it's announced in the last meeting of that Rotary year. And when the announcement was made and that I would be president, that group, that table, stood up and led a standing ovation, which makes me cry even to tell you, because it was very just touching that they would be able to tolerate, really, moving from such angry rejection to a point of acceptance. Since that time, the majority, not 100%, but we'll go with 99%, of my experiences in Rotary, be it my club, my district, I do international service, have been men being very accepting of women and seeing what I think most women in Rotary now hear, is that having women has really made the organization so much better. I think we all know that there are people that still wish that there were no women in, a lot of men that wish that there were no women in Rotary, but they're faceless to me. So you're asking about my personal experience, and I would say I don't actually know them. Maybe my friends.
Thank you.
Joined Rotary in 1997, and I shared this story with some women before the meeting started, and I think it's really appropriate. We all say, well, we want to make a change in our communities, we want to make it better. I honestly can't say that as the reason that I joined Rotary. I knew nothing about the organization. my boss at an administrators meeting one Monday morning said, and this is a quote, "Will somebody join that damn Rotary Club so Brad Ford will get off my ass?" Brad Ford was a member of the Amesbury Rotary Club, and every single year he asked the superintendent of schools to join the Rotary Club. And the superintendent of schools had no intention of ever joining the Rotary Club. He would see if somebody else would be interested, but he had no intention. I didn't realize it. I was new to the team. I didn't realize that that question meant you were supposed to look down at your agenda, not look around the room to see who was going to join the Rotary Club. I looked around to see who was going to raise their hand, and guess what? My eyes met the superintendent's eyes, and 3 months later, I was attending the Rotary Club in Amesbury, Massachusetts. But I will tell you that very, very quickly, I learned that this was a group of people in the community of Amesbury that knew the ins and the outs. Anything I needed, anything I wanted in the school department, those were the 40 people that could make it happen. I'd never have been part of a club with 250 members. But they really were the movers and shakers in this community. And they really helped me with my job. So for me, professionally, Rotary was this opening of the door to this community that had not always been the case in other communities in which I'd been a school administrator or a teacher or whatever I was doing. So in that regard, it was a very, very significant happenstance that I just didn't look down. Personally, my husband had just died 2 months before, and I needed a place to go where I could be just me, and everybody wouldn't say, "Oh, we're so sorry," and "Oh, what can we do?" I had enough casseroles to last a year. I just needed to be able to move on, and Rotary gave me that. So when I think about the joining part of Rotary, for me personally, it became my family. And so for those 4 or 5 years, and then, I mean, the stories I could tell you when I started dating again, oh my gosh, those men, they were my big brothers, my uncles. They vetted everybody that came with me. I mean, they told me one guy straight out, "Don't ever bring him back." They didn't like it, you know, and he didn't come back. What can I say? But I never felt unwelcome. I never felt like I didn't belong in this club. And in fact, I've been a member of 3 clubs in this district. I have always felt very welcome. Now, maybe it was because it was 10 years into the women being a part of the club. When I've gone to other parts of the world as a board of directors member, I have sensed that maybe I wasn't as welcome there as I am in the United States. But clearly here, I felt very welcome. But unfortunately, there's a club in Tennessee right now. It came before the board of directors last year. They don't allow women. Tennessee, the district of our sitting president. And their excuse, and I'll use that word deliberately, their excuse is the women aren't qualified. Belonging. So as a board, we talk about that. Parts of Europe, women are not allowed. Parts of Mexico, women are not allowed. I had the pleasure of sitting with a group of women from the El Paso area that were getting some resistance, and they said, fine. They started their own club. They allow men. They do have a few men that have joined it, so they have not excluded men, but they were like, you know what, we want to be a part of the organization. We're bigger than that, and we're going to do what we need to do. So for me personally, it's been a very positive experience. The leadership opportunities that I've been afforded sitting on the International Board of Directors is absolutely incredible. And I can talk more about that later, but so I've always felt welcome.
Thank you.
So we've got 1.2, a little bit over 1.2 million members. 21% of that, those members are women. And people say, well, that's really good. It's been 30 years. That's really good. And I keep thinking, wait a minute, we're half the population.
we should be half of the membership. I see a huge potential for growth if we would just get our clubs to be half women, half men, or at least moving in that direction. But when we do the breakdown, the age groups, under 29 is only 2% of our membership. 30 to 39 is 8%. 40 to 59 is 41%. And then I'm in this last category, 60 plus, and we're 49% of the membership. Now, I like to think that I'm a young 60 plus, and that I have a lot to offer, and I hope I have good health, and I do have lots to offer for many more years. But clearly, if we're going to grow as an organization, if we're going to continue to meet the needs, not only of young girls, of children, we need to look at our women leaders. We have a foundation that focuses on children and maternal health, on literacy, on economic development. And when you look at the UN and the World Bank and these international organizations, what they tell us is when you meet the needs of young girls and women, you not only meet the needs of those families, but you meet the needs of those communities and ultimately the needs of the world. So we have, I think one of our questions, Amy, was how would you rate Rotary, what grade would you give Rotary International on development, women's development? And I'd say we're probably a C minus. We definitely can do better. And especially once we get into senior leader positions. I was telling a group earlier, I am only the seventh woman ever to serve on the Rotary International Board of Directors. There are currently three other women serving, so we have 8, 9, and 10, and 11 serving right now. After, in a year from now, there will only be one woman on the board. The group that's following her, there are no women, and it looks like the group following her, there are no women on the board of directors. So it's a process to become a director, and you have to be willing to do that, so it just doesn't happen. But at the same time, there are some roadblocks that are put in the way, not only for women, but for men as well, as serving on the Rotary International Board and serving as president, trustee. So we need to look at our organization about growing young instead of growing older and wiser. We can grow younger and wiser. There's lots that needs to be done as far at the international level, in service, in friendship and fellowship, as well as leadership positions.
Thank you. Well, I think I just have to sort of find the right place. If you can hear, then is that okay?
That's
okay.
Fine. I just want to make it easier.
No, it's okay. I just have to make it easier. In 1989, as a brand new Rotary member, not really a Rotarian, because I still didn't know what I was doing or what I was really going to do at Rotary, but I was in Marco Island on vacation, the only time I've been there, and I did a Rotary makeup, which I am a huge believer in Rotary makeups, so I was thrilled, and I was going to go back, and I was going to report about it to the club. Well, at the table, there was a fellow sitting at the end and I was sitting here, and he engaged me in a lot of conversation about me, and it was very positive, and all of a sudden he said, and the rest of the members were sitting, or many members were sitting around this table, he said, well, did you join Boy Scouts too? And I said, oh no, I really never was interested in that, and he was so angry that he didn't get under my skin that he got up and he made some pronouncement and left the meeting. That was not good, but what was important to me about that moment was the people, the Rotary members at that table cheered when he left. And that was, again, from my view, a huge vote of kindness and acceptance on their part, that there are going to be people just in any parts of our lives that don't agree with who we are or what we're doing, And yet that's not the majority. And again, to reiterate what we've been talking about, all over the world that's been my experience. Africa is where I spend a lot of time, as much as I can, and still hold down my job. And particularly Nigeria, especially, and somehow in Uganda. But in both countries, as I began working there, women were club members, but not necessarily club leaders. The evolution, I think, has been very quick for them. Women are now club leaders, and Julia, you might know, but I don't recall for sure that there's a district governor. Who's around? Do you think there? Okay, good. Okay. And, well, I'm mostly in 9125, which is Northern Nigeria, and it's Muslim, and so not so many there. In Uganda, women are certainly, I think, on a par with men in Rotary, and in many respects, excelling in terms of project and leadership development. So I think it is very culturally diverse, and as we've talked about, it's a process, and it's in pockets, and we're all working toward the same service, but we're doing it different ways with different speeds, and you just kind of hang in there.
Thank you. All right, well, I think in reality, we have to focus on not only female. We are very blessed in our district that all of our clubs are way above the international aspect of 21%. I'm very thrilled that Amesbury is 57.7%. Parkway is 50%. Peabody is 47.9%. And Marblehead Harbor is 44.3%. And I just heard that our E-Club is 70% female. So we are truly, truly making a difference. I love the fact that we're here today talking about females. However, we have to remember that Rotary has to be in a position that all of our clubs, and I'm not crazy over that word club, for the simple reason that I want it to be more inclusive, and sometimes club, that word can be a little bit of a hindrance. So I like to say we're the Salem Rotary or the Amesbury Rotary. But we have to really think about our organization reflecting the community that we live in, the community that we're in, whether it's a college Rotaract, are those college students from various different countries, are they joining for one reason, to become better at one avenue of their life, or many avenues of their life? Do we, as Rotarians, join the organization to reflect our needs, or do we join to reflect a combination of not only our needs, but the community needs and the world's needs? And I have to admit, I'm a little selfish. I joined Rotary for a selfish reason, fine. I became a much better person because of Rotary. I became, I think, a true Rotarian by caring about others and knowing that those that are with me in Rotary feel the same exact way. We want to leave the world a little better because we were there.
Thank you. All right, we'll go for one more big question, and we'll throw it to the audience for questions for all four people at the table today. What is the future of Rotary International as far as inclusiveness, accessibility, and diversity? Where will it be in 10 years from now, and where will it be 20 years from now? I'll let you decide who wants to go first.
Well, I think that's up to us in the room, where we'll be in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. You know, the sitting on the board of directors for the last 2 years, it became very clear to me we could make policies, we could put money for advertising campaigns, we could create a new branding tools, we could put out membership tools, but if Rotarians don't embrace those, it's for naught. So I think it's really up to us, and I, you know, it sounds corny, but somebody asked me, sort of, through the superintendent of schools to join a club. Somebody asked you to come and speak. Somebody, you saw these somebodies having fun and found out more about it. You know, we have a, if this is something that we believe in and believe that we make a difference, it's up to us to do the ask, to invite people to say, please join us. You may not like it, but come and give it a shot, give it a try. Just like Amy's talked about, she received something from the organization. I think we all receive something. It may not be a financial scholarship, it may not be a recognition of some kind, but we all receive something internally. So I'm actually quite optimistic about our future. I believe that, how do I want to say this? The old guys are dying, and that don't want to expand. They're dying. And President Robbie last year told a group in Ireland and Great Britain, continue to resist allowing women. You will die, and they will take over. That's what the president of Rotary International from Sri Lanka told the Brits. So I think I'm pretty safe saying the old guys are going to die, and it's up to us if there are folks there to replace them that are more contemporary, that are more progressive, and that see the needs in the world. So I'm feeling quite optimistic. Not that old guys are going to die, but that the organization is saying, you know what, we're going to move forward. We're going to do the right things. We're going to assess our priorities. We're going to create models that are more usable, that are workable, that are part of the 21st century. We're going to work on technology. We're going to work on communications. We're going to put all the tools out there. It's up to us then to use those. So in that regard, I think 10 years, we're going to be strong. 20 years, even stronger.
I would agree with Julia. I am crazy optimistic about Rotary's future. Some specific indicators to me is the active and strategic collaboration between the trustees and the directors. That's a huge change in my mind, in that there's some very beginning. They're really working together, and you know from the inside, but from the not inside, looking at the impact on the organization, it's already very positive. I think there's a fair amount of, it's way past speculation, it's not in the stage that, as I understand it, of actual concrete plans, but I think there is some investigation, might be the best word, for what Rotary might be like as a less centralized organization that meets culturally more needs, and that maybe 10 years from now or 20 years from now we may see a different structure that has twice as many members, and that's certainly the goal, is to expand and create less of a system and more of an engagement. So we'll kind of see if that happens. I mean, I think some of those ideas are being not just played with, but explored in a pretty intentional way in the best interest of Rotary International members. And as Julia said, it's up to us. They aren't doing much without us, is one of the things that I've learned from even being on the programs committee. I'm like thrilled and startled to realize how much value they now place in members' opinions, district members' opinions. It doesn't matter. You have to have a title. They want to know what's going on in the field. And when I was asked to be on the programs committee, I would have to say to you, I had no clue, one. because Tusu is from Uganda. It was very clear why he was asked. Pam Russell is from California. Oh my gosh, the big, it's a very big bucks district, and they do a fabulous job of raising millions of dollars every year. And there needs to be three trustees and three not trustees, and I was the third of the three not trustees. I don't raise huge amounts of money, and I live in Illinois, for heaven's sakes. So as it turned out, it is my work in the field, at cross-culturally, both in the United States and abroad, and I'm really thrilled that somebody thought that I had something to offer. I've learned a lot more than I've given. It's a lot of hard work and the most fun Rotary job I've ever had. But really, in all, I've really come to have incredibly more respect for the directors and the trustees because they work so hard, and I didn't really get that before, to really try to do what's best for the organization. So I have to be optimistic, even really optimistic.
Thank you, Julia. I am extremely, extremely optimistic on where we will be in the future. I have no doubt that we are going to grow. And that reason is because I look out here tonight and I see the audience that is here. I see the young. I see some of the not so young. I see the diversity in race. I see the diversity in cultures. I see the male, the female. We're all here for one reason, and that is to make a difference in our world. So I am so optimistic. Do I believe we're going to have a woman Rotary International President soon? Yes, I do. Do I believe that we will continue with the good work that we are doing and expand it and save more lives and help more children? Education, water, health, so many wonderful things that Rotarians do. And it's because of each and every one of you. It's not because of you men over in Rotary International are giving us guidelines. It's because we are owning Rotary. We are making a difference in making Rotary our own to reflect our cultures, to reflect who we are and what we want to do. And as Rotary International President John Duran said, you do it and we will catch up to you. But you are the most important person in Rotary, and don't ever forget that.
Thank you. We're gonna move into a short Q&A. Very well deserved round of applause. I'm sure there will be many later also. If you have a question, raise your hand and I can bring the mic to you.
Good evening, my name is Caitlin Clark, and I want to thank you all for coming to be able to speak today. So I just had a question, and I love this panel, and it's so appropriate given the political environment right now. I mean, whatever your feelings about Hillary Clinton, really she's broken barriers in terms of women being able to seek an office that high. So I'm just curious, and maybe this is a question for Sheryl, but Julia, I know your involvement in 7930. I'm sure you could chime in as well. So the clubs with the over 40% of women, do you know if they're doing something differently? Are they actively seeking women out? Or what have we done any kind of research or gotten any metrics to figure out if those clubs are doing something differently to attract women?
In reality, I do not think that we have actually done statistical analysis on why or how, but I will tell you that Julia happens to be a member of the Amesbury Rotary, which has the highest level, and she can actually address that. But the one thing I want to say is I really truly feel that women now know they can raise up their hand and invite someone who they know will make a difference regardless of the gender of that person. But Julia, why don't you talk about Amesbury?
When I joined the Amesbury Club, there were eight women.
we did a fundraiser, and the president came to me and said, would you have a problem if we did the women against the men? So there was a table of women, and there were three tables of men. And we were, you know, selling tickets. The women were kicking tail on this. I mean, we were selling more tickets, which it's the year that we sold the most tickets ever for this event. The men were so upset that they were getting beat, because they all had 10 or 12 people on their team because there were more of them. There were just eight of us. That on the last day, when we had our little thermometer, you know, we could see that the women were really going to win this, one guy bought the remaining tickets, so his team would win. Now, I tell you that story because at first it kind of got under my skin, and I thought, well, that isn't fair. But you know what? The bottom line, we sold all of our tickets that year. We raised more money than we had ever raised before. So then I thought, well, okay, so we were a good catalyst for a little bit of that. So that's a little bird walk. But I think part of that club is we've had strong women presidents, and I would put myself in that category, and we just reached out. And it didn't really matter if it was men or women. We wanted the very, very best members possible. The year my husband was president, though, he wanted it to be 50-50. And he made that statement. I want us to be 50-50. And it didn't happen this year, but it happened the next year. And they were the first ones in the district to achieve that. And so it's kind of a badge of honor. And I think that badge of honor is like, hey, look what we did. We still want to be in that position, you know, that healthy competition. I don't think we exclude men. I know we don't exclude men. But we are looking at some really unique ways to involve folks in the club. So we're going to one evening a month. We're doing a meeting in the evening, and we're doing something called service members, and we're doing it primarily for the folks that can't come during the middle of the day and eat lunch with us. So guess who we're picking up? We're picking up teachers, which, what's the sex of teachers primarily? We're women. You know, that was my vocation. So we're picking up a lot of women in our service member roles, women nurses, women social workers, women teachers, women doctors that can't get away in the middle of the day. So I don't think we're deliberately doing that, but I think just because we're reaching out and trying to be more inclusive and trying to represent our community, which is half women, that's what's happening. I don't think it's, I mean, it has been consciously stated by, of course, Steve didn't really have a choice. You know, he lives with me, so he's heard this soapbox before. But I think the other clubs are conscious of it, too. They're really reaching out to say, where can we find really good members? And there are really good male members, and there are really good female members, and so we're looking for quality.
Amy? I'm not sure I remember the question. Oh, it was that. Oh, it was your question.
Yes.
Are the clubs doing something specific?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
I'm not so involved in the answer. I forgot the question. I don't think that our club, the Rockford Rotary Club, is a prime example of what should be done. I can tell you what we have done, and we have 48% women, and I really do think it is somewhat related to what Julia was talking about, is strong women asking strong women to join. We also ask strong men to join, so it isn't exclusive in any way. But I have noticed in our club, and there's some intention about mentoring, certainly, but I think the mentoring is more, if I'm going to make a generalization, more effective as I look at women mentoring other women. I think there is maybe more, I don't know what that is. I mean, it sounds pretty sexist, you know, if I say, well, I think they do that better. I'm not sure that's true, but they certainly do it very enthusiastically and consistently. And I think, though, then, that the women that are asked to join find a place, find something that matters to them, the way that they give back. Absolutely. And their attendance is good. They have lots of strong opinions. So they kick in, and then they stay. So I would say maybe that would be the
only thing I've been doing for years. Thank you. Another question? Thank you so much tonight, ladies. This is great. My name is Christine, and I'm actually not from there, from Fitchburg. But my question to you is, on more than one occasion, I heard you say you joined Rotary, and then later on, you more became a Rotarian. Is there a certain project you worked on, or event that took place, or fundraiser that you did that really kind of made you become a Rotarian? Thank you.
Notes all of a sudden it came to me. I joined Rotary again for fun. I started working on projects, found that I loved it. It made a difference. I was very service oriented anyway. However, it was when I realized that we were just one small club in one small community, actually serving community meals. And I looked around the room and I saw my friends, my Rotarians, serving, cleaning, talking to people, making a difference. And it finally dawned on me, this is happening all over the world. And that's when I really changed from being a member of a Rotary Club to being a Rotarian, because I knew whether I was in that other country, whatever I did, I would be able to impact the globe for good by being a Rotarian. I would be able to be, in my eyes, with the best people in the world who truly care about making a difference and who want to make sure that their life mattered.
So I went from being a member of the Amesbury Rotary Club to being a Rotarian while I was club president. And we were asked to sponsor an autistic riding program for 3 children in the Amesbury Public Schools. The school district didn't have enough money to pay for that, so they came to the Rotary Club and said, would you please underwrite this 11-week program? We did. Not every member was enthusiastic about it. One member made me promise that I would never come back to the Rotary Club and ask for money ever again for this program, and I promised him that. I probably had my fingers behind my back when I crossed behind my back, but I promised. Fast forward 11 weeks, we had asked the AV tech at the high school to videotape the whole 11-week project and to put it down into a 15-minute program for our Rotary Club. The day came to show the video of this 11-week project. We invited the parents of these 3 children to come to see the video and for our club to see the video, and so we could say, this is where the $1,100 went. I'm telling you, to watch these children, these 3 autistic children, get on that horse that first day, just to go into the ring where the horse was. They were scared, it was strange, they didn't know what to expect. And then to fast forward to week 11, where they got their saddles and they got on that horse and they were communicating with that horse, you know, go left, go right, go fast, go slow, stop. As I looked at the Rotary members watching this video, I mean, you could tell we were very proud of what we had done and that we had funded this program. And so we do this silly thing called Happy Dollars, and so when it came time after the program, oh my gosh, everybody was happy. Even the banker, who we rarely saw money from him, he pulled out a 20, and we got $20 from Harold that day. And so it was a significant day. We were about ready to wrap up, and the mother said, of one of the little girls said, may I give a Happy Dollar? Now, we'll take money from anybody. So we said, sure. She stood up. And she said, my little girl had never spoken until this program. Last week, she said her first word. She said, Mommy. Well, I'm telling you, the men were blowing their noses like crazy. The women had tears running down their face. And what I realized is that our club of 40 plus members had not only changed that little girl's life, we had changed that mother's life, we had changed that family's life, and every single one of us in that room changed that day. It was something very simple. I didn't have to go, as much as I would love to go to Africa and do a project there, I did it in my own little community of Queensland. And that's when I became a Rotarian. That's when I knew the power of this organization, because I saw that change that day.
I didn't think of the answer in advance, so it's not very well articulated here. I think I became a Rotarian in fits and starts. I very much liked my club, I think you can tell that, and I sought to be involved. But it happened to, at that time, be a club that how you got involved was a mystery, and there wasn't anybody telling you. And I got tired of that after a year or two, and went to the president and said, either give me something to do, or I have to find some other place to be in the club, because I don't know what this is. And so they put me in charge of membership. I was like, no, thanks. So I did that, and that was really great. And I think, again, I think the getting involved and finding where you make a difference helps you in the direction of being a Rotarian, and you figure out on your own when that kind of really gets you. So I do think district involvement was part of it for me, because it helped me kind of really put my finger on how so many people that aren't in the same club and like so many different kinds of projects all work together so effectively most of the time, and certainly work toward something bigger than themselves. So again, that was a piece of it. I would say that that moment of, oh my God, I don't think there were words sometimes, and I think that's what was happening with Julia and her club, when you're so integrally involved with the transformation of yourself, the people around you, and children, you really have become a Rotarian. I think that isn't the only way, but I think that moment for me was, Tom Thorpinson and I have been taking teams to Nigeria to do project development work. He bailed on it and I kept going. Well, I was giving some talks about that work and the children and what children in villages have to endure. And one of my club members was there who went home and changed their will. I did not know this. And let's see, that was in February, and four months later, he died. And I was terribly sad. He was a really good friend. I was terribly sad he died. Anyway, and 2 months after that, I got a call from the state lawyer, his, who told me that he had left $10,000 to help the children in Nigeria stop dying from parasitic illnesses. So this is a happy story. I'm trying to make sure you understand it, but it was a big responsibility and a big honor to know that I had that money plus the Rotary Foundation money that would come with it to help kids. His name is Tom Lindham, in his name. And so the next team that I took, I just knew it. It was there. It was sitting on my shoulder, but I didn't know where that money was going to go. And a little village that the Rotary Club of Kaduna Malala had asked us to go to, quite impulsively, I thought, but anyway, because there had been a polio team had gone through earlier, and the village leader, who's in charge of everybody in the village, had said, we don't have, polio's not a problem, go away. And they went away. And so when I heard that they went away, I couldn't stand it, and I said, okay, we'll go. And we went and found a village where there were 6,000 kids that had never been immunized. And that I think that we can impact that. Now, I was overwhelmed by that, and like, now what do we do? But what we did do is we helped them learn how to put down the floor of a school, a two-room kind of school. And in that process, the village leader, who wouldn't look me in the face because I'm female, wouldn't talk to me because he didn't understand English, just stared at me while all this stuff was going on. And I said, I understand you're worried about your children. And he started to talk English. And from that, I learned that the wells that had been put in by the government 15 or 20 years ago hadn't worked for many, many years. And the kids were drinking out of the cow ponds with the cows. And so he said that the children are dying before they're five. They don't have a chance to get polio. Now it made sense that he said, you know, go away. And so I said, well, we can do something about that. Now, I knew about the money sitting right here, and I thought, this is it. This is where this money's supposed to go. He thought I meant the wells that I'd sent some of my team members off, that kind of have engineering brains and they can fix everything. And they went, and of the two wells, they actually fixed one. And so in the background, you'd hear these children running and screaming and laughing. And these were kids living in the village. I work with depression every day in my office. I'd never seen depression look like this until I was in that village. But these kids were joyous beyond experience. And they had water, and from their view, that was safe, fresh water. So the village leader thought that I meant we can fix your wells, and that's not what I'm talking about. So to kind of make this story short, rather than 2 hours, we did a lot of things in that village, and one of the things we did is we put in two borehole wells that are still working, and none of the kids are getting sick. They are seriously healthy. And 2 weeks after we left, all the kids were immunized against polio. So that power that our team and that village leader had with each other, it wasn't Rotary's power. It was the combination, it was the collaboration, it was the communication that I didn't know I could have with somebody that didn't speak English. I mean, he was faking it, but still. I think that's when I became Rotarian, and so much more committed to do more, even
though you don't necessarily know what more is all the time. So, thanks for listening to that. Well, I can't think of a better way to wrap up the Q&A for this event, and if our panelists are willing to stick around a little longer, you might be able to ask your specific question to them after this. So we've heard about this landmark case and from these phenomenal women leaders who really are paving the way for a younger generation like myself and even young kids in elementary school who Rotary works with. I'd like to bring up our Vice President, Chi Lu Tran, who's a more recent member of Rotary International. She's going to speak for a moment about how Rotary has impacted her life and wrap up our event for the evening. So welcome, Chi.
So good evening. We've been working really hard on this event, and after working on it and planning for it for the past few months and learning more about the extraordinary stories of generosity, leadership, and hard work we have for Women in Rotary, I'm truly excited to be part of Rotary's future, and I feel compelled to share our vision of the world with more and more people. So last month, the idea to write this essay about what Rotaract means to me came to me all of a sudden, and I wasn't sure about how or where to share it until I spoke to Amy last week, and she sort of volunteered me tonight to come up here. So some of you may know that my father passed away about 2 months ago. I'm trying to get through this without crying. But he doted on my sister and me like it was nothing, and we were truly everything to him. He told me he loved me and thanked me during every phone call multiple times. He supported me endlessly, and he actually drove me to the Rotarian membership forum for our district last year, and I met many of you there, and he said that he was really proud that I was an adult businesswoman that Rotary accepted. So he was kind, funny, easygoing, hardworking, and every other positive adjective you can think of, and I can't imagine a better father. So that happened this summer, and now I feel a little bit untethered, uprooted, and directionless, the kind of way you feel after a major loss in your life, like the ground fell out from under me. But the news would tell you that it's not much better outside of my personal life. It's peppered with disasters, tragedies, scandals, and injustice. The outlook is bleak, and I have none of the answers. But I do have some hope, and Rotary pushes me to read the context, to see the bright spots, to see people who disagree with each other still collaborate on solutions to many of the world's problems, to see people cast cynicism aside and help their brothers and sisters. It gives me a path to light and to contributing to the world. I can amplify my time and energy to the group effort and partnerships with extraordinary people. In my own community, I can help teenagers develop coping skills for life and depression through the Adolescent Wellness Project. I can help raise funds to ensure the safe travel of children with the need to go to school. I can support the amazing organization we are raising funds for tonight, one of them being Founding Translation, an organization that helps homeless and low-income women achieve economic security. And through Rotaract, I've made lifelong friends whose kindness throughout my morning cannot be measured. Friends who truly helped me feel less lonely and less empty after this event. It gives me a place to go and just be. It has given me a purpose, and it shows me that I need it and how I need it. And we are truly all needed in this global effort to help others live happier and healthier lives. It helps me live a life that is worthy of the father that I have. Thank you all for listening, and I'd like to introduce Kelly Liu from Founding Translation. She's one of the board members there and is going to share a little bit about the organization, what they do, and how they do it.
Great, thank you so much for that introduction. Again, my name is Kelly Liu, and I'm one of the newer board members of Founding Translation, and also coincidentally the youngest, so don't let that fool you from getting involved. Founding Translation operates at the intersection of two main social issues, and that's the lack of economic opportunity for low-income minority women, and the barriers to access to quality health care for ethnic minorities and immigrants. And so we know that population has been expanding here in the New England area and across our country, and that among those we also have women that are impoverished or formerly homeless that really don't have access to economic opportunities. So our goals are to empower women so that they can reach economic independence, and also help these underserved communities reach the healthcare that they need, either at hospitals or clinics, and in so that we can bridge those language barriers that are keeping them from adequate healthcare. A little bit about our program: it's a 3-month intensive training process where we have women apply, and at the end, they are able to become certified as medical translators. So these women are bilingual, fully bilingual, in their own language and in English as well. A program like ours is typically cost prohibitive. So a portion of our program expenses go towards being able to provide childcare and access to transportation, because these women otherwise are either staying at home, not making money, or they're taking care of children, and the vast majority of them are single women. So this allows them to be barrier-free to actually attend our training course and then reap the benefits of the training that we give them. So just a little bit about our last class. We actually just celebrated our 5-year anniversary at Founding Translation. We were very excited to graduate 37 women who we had chosen out of 479 applications, and among them, they spoke 22 languages. So the languages that we are training women in translating are, it runs the gamut, Mandarin, Haitian Creole, Portuguese, Swahili, Khmer. These women are highly motivated. They're very bright and intelligent. They span between 21 and 47. And like I mentioned, a lot of them are single mothers. Collectively, they had about 40 children. So I'm really excited to be here tonight because I think this is the perfect venue to talk about an organization like ours. We are the beneficiary of all of your donations part of this event tonight. So thank you. And like any nonprofit, there's always more work to do. So beyond just your financial contributions, we could really use your skills and talent and motivation and excitement. So I am actively recruiting board members. If you're interested in learning more about our organization, you can contact me. I am not going to be able to be here too much longer tonight, so I'll leave my contact information at the sign-in table over there. Thank you.
Thank you for being here today to talk about Found in Translation, and thank you to you for being so vulnerable to share this story about your life and how Rotary's been a part of helping you get through it. And I'm proud to call you a friend and fellow Rotarian. So that's it for the night. I think about $300 worth of pizzas are going to come out, so if you have a minute and you're really hungry, they'll be right in the back of the room. I would be remiss if I didn't thank some folks who helped us out tonight. Michael Scannell, who is a rock star with AV at the last minute. We had some failed efforts to coordinate that. Of course, the Back Bay Social Club for donating the venue and those pizzas that will be very delicious. Boys Direct, Spot Hero, WICN featured us on a recent Business Beat episode. Sheryl, myself, as well as Dave Gardner, who is another Rotarian in our district. We also have Rotarian partners, District 7930 from Downtown Boston Rotary Club, Rotary Club of Boston number 7, and I think everyone in this room. Thank you for being here. Thank you for making this event great. Thank you to our wonderful panelists and for Carol. It's been really awesome, and I hope that we can continue having fellowship after this tonight. One more thing. Also at the sign-up table, if you have to scoot out or just want more information, we'll take your name to pass it on to Founded Translation. If you're interested in becoming a Rotaractor, Rotarian, we'll also take your name for that. Thank you, and have a good night. Thank you.